So back then to completion itself, and as I said, I think there's a mismatch between simply the easy way out, which is to link practical completion or substantial completion to registration. I don't think it's fair on the contractor, and I think it's allocating risk, you know, in an inappropriate manner. I think there is a way around it, and I've done it on a number of projects that we've been involved in where, to be fair, systems on the other side are being realistic about what it means, why the allocation should be different to what's contained in the GCCC contracts. So maybe in a design and build contract it's fair to, because the contractor is, you know, control of everything, but in a traditional certainly not. So I think, you know, in your main contract, you need to draft clauses to differentiate between practical completion in the sense of all of the works being done so that the building's practically ready for use with the exception of snag items, and registration. So there's two relevant dates, and then you look and you say, okay, well, what are the consequences of practical completion in a normal contract? And there's a couple of different points. The first one is insurances and possession of the site. So if, through no fault of the contractor, registration is delayed, so assume the contractor has reached practical completion, but registration is delayed because of an error by the assigned certifier. Who's maintaining insurance on the premises and who's maintaining possession of the premises? That's simply an issue which has to be resolved between the client and the contractor. But if it's the contractor certainly should be getting paid for it and be entitled to be paid for it. The next point, what about release of retention and the commencement of defects liability period? Now, okay, the contractor would say, well, look, you know, I want my risk to run from the time I complete my works. But I think, in fairness, the argument from the client is probably strong. The client would say, well, I'm not actually getting to use the building until after registration. So, therefore, you know, I'm not going to see what errors there are, and I'm not going to use any of the plant and equipment. So, really, the defects liability period should run from registration, even if that is a few weeks after the contractor has reached what otherwise would be practical completion. And similarly, the release of retention should run from registration as opposed to from practical completion in a normal sense. But what about liquidated damages? Again, I would say if it's that registration is delayed through no fault of the contractor, then liquidated damages shouldn't be applied for a period between his practical completion and the registration. Why should he be penalized for something that the assigned certifier has done wrong? As regards subcontracts, yes, there is no obligation to provide an ancillary cert at the moment, so a main contractor needs to make sure that there's an obligation on a subcontractor to provide them, and similarly, if you're advising the client, you need to make sure that there's an obligation on a main contractor to procure ancillary certs from the subcontractors. The form needs to be agreed both in the form of appointment between the client and the assigned certifier, and also in the main contract, and obviously also then flowing down into the subcontract. Similarly, there needs to be a specific obligation on the main contractor to cooperate with the assigned certifier and to procure the cooperation of subcontractors with the assigned certifier. Another specific obligation on the contractor to comply with the inspection plan and to procure the cooperation of, or procure the compliance by its subcontractors with the inspection plan. Collateral warranties then have become kind of even more of a touchy subject than was previously the case. And I suppose there's varying arguments as to, you know, whether there needs to be a collateral warranty from a subcontractor in favor of third parties, or whether there needs to be a collateral warranty in favor of a design certifier or an assigned certifier, or whether the design certifier and the assigned certifier can simply rely on the ancillary certs. Now, I suppose if I was advising a subcontractor providing an ancillary cert, I might prefer to have a collateral warranty with an assigned cert because at least I can include limitations on liability in the collateral warranty. Absent a collateral warranty, I'm probably open-ended, because a claim would be made in tort, and the relevant tort would be the tort of negligent misstatement, which is one of, which is the only exception to the rule in tort that you can't recover economic loss. So, in essence, what I'm saying is, absent a collateral warranty, there's a non. If you as an assigned certifier are trying to recover from an ancillary certifier, you won't have. If you don't have a collateral warranty, there's no contract in place between you. But because you're suing in negligent misstatement, you will have an opportunity to recover unlimited damages. If there's a collateral warranty, there may be some limitation contained in that contract between you and the ancillary certifier. So, I suppose, just in conclusion, I suppose when SI9 was introduced last year, I think there was a sense among some that, look, it'll be all right on the night. Once it's introduced and we all get used to it, we'll work out a way of getting through it, and everybody will be fine if we're all settled down. But I think certainly from a construction lawyer's perspective, as we've got into it, we've actually realised that it has created a huge, huge, complex drafting issue, which I don't think we've ever envisaged. A lot of that, yes, is due to the fault of the legislation itself, but in a sense, anyone can do it at the current review, go past that, so we just have to get on with it. And I suppose my message to you is, you have to think, and you have to, in my view, go through the code of practice, go through the legislation, and actually sit down and work out, as if you were listing out the services that you want somebody to provide, what services do you want, if you're advising a client, what services do you want as a client, the assigned certifier, to actually carry out? And you need to make those specific. So if you want the assigned certifier to be the liaison point for everything to do with building control authority, the building control authority, you need to specify that. Again, if you want a contractor to cooperate with the assigned certifier, you need to specify that in your contract with the main contractor. You need to get him to procure the subcontractor's cooperation. If you don't and you simply say everybody will comply with the building control regs or everybody will comply with the code of practice, from a client's perspective, the client is going to get hammered with variation claims. And if the client gets hammered with variation claims, and for advice you've given him in relation to the use of a particular contract or form of contract, then you're open to. So there's a body of work to be done before you issue contracts or before you advise the client to engage a separate assigned certifier. Or a phase in which there is a possibility that you're going to be drawn into the legal process.